On this episode, swords, stingray-looking things, mechs, and flannel. Plus, I compare a lot of things to Godzilla. I don't know. Just start the damn thing. Golvellius, Valley of Doom, has a reputation built on its similarity to Zelda, even though Golden Axe Warrior was more of a blatant ripoff. Simply put, if Golvellius were anywhere near as large as a Zelda game, I wouldn't have to explain it to you right now. Regardless, it feels like a pretty conspicuous hole in the Master System's library, which probably explains the demand for it. I think it cost me $60 on eBay, and is it worth it? Yeah, I guess. This was made by Compile the same year as the Master System port of R-Type, which I'm sure you're aware I enjoyed. They were given the mission of porting some of Sega's early stuff to the SG-1000 and did so pretty well, eventually being given stuff like Lode Runner and Choplifter. Golvellius originally came out in 1987 for the MSX and was beefed up a year later for the Master System / Mark III. That went over so well that it was ported back to the MSX, this time on the MSX2 standard. 1988 was a pretty good year for Compile, because not only did they do this and R-Type came out, but The Guardian Legend for the NES, Alien Crush for the TurboGrafx, and even fucking Aleste, which you never hear anyone talk shit about. Anyway, geez, God, I need to focus. From the outset, things are hella Zelda 2-ish, although not so much in the way you'd expect. Scrolling goes right only, and your sword attack is a little lacking. Still, this was kind of a fun way to start stuff out. Once that's complete, you enter the overworld. On each and every screen, there's a hidden hole. Sometimes they're open automatically, sometimes you need to kill enemies, sometimes you attack rocks or trees or whatever to open them. You'll find fairies giving you weird hints, old ladies selling you Bibles or crystals or whatever, and occasionally a Randar, who will heal you. So, in a lot of cases, you'll be grinding for gold to buy stuff from various old ladies. It seems like it'd be aggravating, but before long, you'll figure out which enemies are both easy to kill and deep-pocketed. Getting killed sucks, and here's the big caveat. Sega was stingy when it came to battery backups. Monopoly and Penguin Land had batteries, but not this? So you're stuck with massive passwords. Kind of a kick in the gut, but to be fair, it's a lot easier to snap them with your phone nowadays. Once you reach the bosses, they're not particularly cheap, which is cool. What's whack is, once they're dead, you're allowed to buy the crystal that grants passage to the next section of the map, but you still gotta pay for the thing? Fuck. By the end of the game, you have the ability to walk on water, across pits, across virtually everything. It feels like an awkward combination between powerful and lazy, like you're some kind of pipsqueak Godzilla. The game culminates in the final dungeon where you fight Golvellius and he, turns good and becomes your friend? You do you, dude. Part of me thinks I need to start issuing number scores to this stuff, because I'll complain about it, like, wild, even if I like the game. And that's the case here. It really should have been longer, and if they truly had Imitating Zelda in mind, a second quest would have been fantastic. I tend to favor the first two Zelda games over all the rest, so that might appeal to me more than most people. Probably a 7. Anyway, after loving Thunder Force 2 and R-Type, I started digging around and researching other 16-bit Sega shooters, and I kind of wanted something biomechanical and Giger-esque like R-Type is. Aside from those weird, gory Japanese PC things that came out in the past 10 or 20 years, and you can't find them anywhere, pickings were slimmer than I thought. And I wound up with Biohazard Battle, which was a little less Necronom 5 and a little more Captain Planet or whatever. In Japan, it's titled Crying, Aseime Sensu, which means Crying, Sublife War. Cool, good. You have your choice of four ships from the outset, each with different combinations of various weapons. All that stuff's listed in the manual, but I'll leave that up to you, to each their own. The game opens with a pretty cool surface descent before the game kicks into gear in the traditional way. Your secondary weapon fires in the opposite direction of your movement. There's a weapon I hate in Thunder Force 2 that does this, and a game based entirely around this mechanic is pretty maddening. Each of the four ships has different reactions to the four weapon pickups. You can stack them, and I find more often than not, if you can get the powered up orange homing laser thing, it tends to knock shit out before it becomes your problem. The graphics are competent, the controls aren't crappy, and you don't instantly die when you smack walls, so that's cool. Not sure what else there is to say. Something about it just didn't grab me, though. I hate to be this person, but I was spoiled by R-Type and Thunder Force too. There is a two-player mode, but like, I'm not begging Lana to play this. She's got an animal restaurant to look after. There's not much else to say. It's hella middle of the road. Can't dunk on it, not thrilled about it. Up next is Battletech. I can already hear it now. Isn't Battletech cyberpunk? No, it's hard sci-fi, and I'm pretty sure since the co-creator of Battletech is the same dude that invented Shadowrun, clearly he could have mushed them together if that was the case. Battletech, originally named Battle Droids by Jordan Wiseman and L. Ross Babcock III, originated as a board game primarily comprised of a map with hexagonal spaces and miniature robot mechs. I know I'm watering it down, but whatever. Not too much was done with the license in terms of console gaming, because it probably would have looked a lot like an imitation of Nobunaga's ambition. Outside of consoles, there were Battletech centers, networked cockpits set up in various arcades or warehouses or whatever around the states. Imagine you and 15 friends steering your individual mechs into wild-ass first-person battles. To be honest, even today it sounds pretty fucking dope. Eventually this stuff died off as Everything But Love does, but there are still two remaining centers in Texas and Minnesota. A way stripped-down home version finally arrived in 1993 for the Super NES under the name Mech Warrior, and a year later Sega got an isometric action game using the license. The game I'm going on about today is simply called Battletech, and it feels a little bit more like controlling a miniature on a map than its predecessor. Not only that, but a lot of the complicated details have been replaced by a simple weapon selection screen, and the consoleification of Battletech is made complete. Malibu Interactive put this together, and in my opinion, they crushed it. There's a Godzilla-esque sense of ant-like soldiers trying their damnedest to take you down as you complete objective-based missions across 5 stages. You get to choose one of 3 weapons per controller button, which is kind of fun, although one or two of the weapons seem flat-out useless. Every now and then an enemy mech approaches, at which point a sampled voice says, "Enemy mech approaching," and now you have to try a bit harder to defend yourself. Objectives are like you'd expect. Destroy some power plants or hangars or weird pyramid things. There's a neat mechanic where once you hold down a weapon button, you can rotate your turret as you keep walking in the way you were walking when you started firing, if that makes sense. A bizarro two-player mode incorporates that in a you-steer-I'll-push-the-pedals kind of way. One person controls the mech's legs, the other controls the top half. I imagine this resulted in a lot of sibling fistfights back in the day. I feel like if this game is known for anything, it's an uneven learning curve. The first stage is a good place to learn the basics of movement and a modest challenge, but then the second stage puts you in a hostile environment with an opening objective that's too tightly time-based. With the third stage, it's as if the second never happened and the difficulty goes back to increasing reasonably. Nearly every video about this game complains about that second stage, so I'm gonna do something different and show you how to kill it. Pick the Aero 6, Laser, and the Inferno. The layout of the launch sites you're looking for relative to where you start is an upside-down triangle. Move slightly to the right and start working down from there. The jagged lava bits on the ground will damage you, but your mech will cool down after. The crater volcano things, on the other hand, will fuck you up. It's a simple matter of waiting for them to fire and running after. If at any point you find coolant and don't need it, leave it. This includes at the beginning of the stage. You'll get one for destroying the launch site in the upper right corner of the map also, and probably not a moment too soon. Once all three are gone, you can take all the time you want. Be cautious, and from here on out you'll be fine. It helps to use the hell out of the radar you're given. Don't say I never taught you nothing. This exact game was repackaged as Mech Warrior 3050 and re-released for the Super NES a year and a half later. And to make things slightly more confusing, that original first Super NES game was also just called Battletech in Japan. Of the stuff I covered in this episode, I'd probably say Battletech was the best to a small degree. I keep thinking Golvellius could have been so much longer. So, in conclusion, you can click on this smug picture of me from 2 years ago and get hella subscribed. Subscribers of this channel get exclusive benefits like YouTube texts you every Wednesday. I promise I'm going to chill out on the shooter stuff for a while, at least until Fantasy Zone gear comes along. See ya.